Hey, good morning to you. Morning. And I'm not going to tell you how to pray. that has been told you by many, many people down through the ages. I'm going to share with you ideas on how Christ attempted to tell his disciples to pray. I want to welcome all of you that are here this morning, and to those of you that are watching at home, a very, very good day to each and every one of you. Before we get started with the talk for this morning, I'm going to ask perhaps that you sit back in your chairs, put both feet flat on the floor. We'll take a few moments to work upon the health of our bodies. Because in the world that we live in, with all of the stresses and strains and turmoils and so forth, it's good to sit back and to get centered in on that natural healing intelligence within us. So let your eyes close, if you would, and just think along with me for a few moments. I turn away from the outer world to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. For a few moments, to enter into a state of communion with that higher state of consciousness and awareness that has healed me so many times throughout my life. For here within my body is the great intelligence that created it. That intelligence that has healed my body many times over, time and again throughout my life, from minor things to major things. And that healing intelligence is as an inner light within me. My body is as an energy field. And that inner light is the primal energy of the universe. It is the original light from which all other energies came forth, inclusive of all of the energies that comprise every localized part of my body, all of the involuntary organs of my body. Therefore, here within myself, there is a light energy that has dominion over all of the lesser energies that comprise my physical body. That energy, that light right now, let me feel is entering into the nucleus of each and every cell of my body, into all of the millions of cells of my body, from the top of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. And that as that light enters into each cell, it adjusts the rhythms, the motions, the energy factors of each cell, harmonizing each cell with the divine design of God, as God intended my body to function perfectly and in harmony with all of nature. And so throughout my body now, let me feel the divine rhythms of nature like a beautiful melody in perfect harmony with the divine design of God, is balancing, stabilizing, bringing into perfect harmony with divine design all that is within my body, that whatever is in need of healing is being healed. And that in the mind of God, that healing has already taken place. That mind of God is the light that is entering all of the cells of my body. And so as it is so in the mind of God, that my body is functioning perfectly in wholeness and in health, I feel a state of peace, quiet, a loving kindness of the Great Spirit that is God, that has blessed me throughout my body with light, with love, with health, with healing, with wholeness. For this, to God's presence at the center of my beingness, I give thanks. I let it be so, and so it is. This morning's subject deals with results from prayer. That's an important subject because I'm sure everybody that's here this morning, at one time or another, or perhaps many, many times throughout your life, has taken time to pray. Most people don't pray, unfortunately, until they are in a point of desperation. Everything else has been tried, and now, in one final act of crying out for mercy, out goes a prayer. The prayer, as most of you that were brought up in a traditional form of religion, goes forth into the ethers, into the atmosphere, perhaps in a more traditional sense, up into the clouds somewhere, as someone tries to imagine that there is a presence of God. Prayer has been used time and time again, and many times it has been answered, and many times it hasn't been answered. Now, that causes a question. It is a very, very big question. I always believe that if you're going to approach spirituality, you don't approach it from rose-colored glasses. I'm sorry. Certainly, we can be positive about everything, but positiveness carried to its absolute state is reality, isn't it? I mean, if you think about what reality is, it is absolute positiveness. Because you can't be positive about anything unless you know the reality behind the thing. So today we have people, right now, while we're here, praying. Praying for health, praying for money, praying for love, praying for happiness, praying for all manner of things. We know, as human beings, if we're honest, we know that not all of these prayers are going to be answered. We just know it. Now, someone can be very, very philosophical and theological and simply say, well, all prayers are answered. Except sometimes God says no. Okay? That can be philosophical. And it can be theological. It sort of makes sense on the surface, doesn't it? I mean, you ask for something, you don't get it, so if God heard it, obviously the answer was, no, you can't have that thing. And yet, in the Bible, and this verse is quoted quite frequently, whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. Whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. Now that's pretty cut and dry, isn't it? But let's suppose that we have all of these people that are praying, they're believing. Now maybe you might say, well, they're not believing hard enough. They don't have enough faith. They're just using it momentarily to try to slip something in on the universe. And the universe doesn't quite really realize what's taking place. Maybe we'll slip one in, get it by, get the prayer answered regardless. When we look at the New Testament, if you look at it for a guideline for prayer, you have to understand that prayer is not as in traditional Christianity it is taught. In traditional Christianity, you'll get that one verse, but you won't get the most important thing. What is prayer? Because it says, praying, if you pray and believe, it'll be answered. You'll receive. But what is prayer? Is prayer folding our hands and looking up at the clouds somewhere? Is prayer saying an affirmation, a positive affirmation, that good is already ours? What is prayer? Jesus answered it and described it to his disciples. He said, "Be ye not as the hypocrites, seen in the synagogues, praying before men. When thou prayest, enter into thy closet, shut the door behind thee, and pray to thy Father which seeth in secret." Those are instructions for meditation. Now, that's one of the affirmations you have on your affirmation card here this morning. So what was Jesus saying about prayer? He was saying prayer is meditation. It isn't petitioning. It isn't just simple believing. It is meditation. And what is meditation? Meditation is a state of consciousness. Meditation is a state of mind. Now, if you are in a state of mind where you are in communion with God consciousness, then as we're going to go over here in a few moments, it is as if you do not direct prayer, rather that what you are going to pray for has been directed into you preceding your prayer. This is sort of convoluted here and complex. What I'm saying is a strange thing as far as Christianity is concerned in a traditional sense. And remember, I've taught that there are two Christianities: the outer Christianity, which most people are aware of, and the inner Christianity, which few people are aware of because few are interested. The Christianity that few are interested in is the one that Jesus taught to his immediate disciples. It was the mystical aspect. So what am I saying here, in effect? I'm saying that when you pray, you go into a state of meditation, that in essence, what Jesus referred to as prayer in the New Testament is meditation. In fact, the whole of the New Testament deals with meditation. Time after time, if you were to go home this afternoon and to read the New Testament from cover to cover, what you would find is that there are constant references to the kingdom of heaven. Why go into all of these references to the kingdom of heaven when, if in a traditional Christian state, all it is after death? Why? Because he was trying to explain what couldn't be explained in ordinary words, because people were not interested, they did not have that consciousness to be able to understand that this kingdom of heaven was a higher state of consciousness, that one experiences the presence of God within themselves. And hence we enter into a communion, union with God. The body becomes the holy temple, the holy shrine of God. As above, so below. The finite within the infinite within the finite. Inseparable, the Father and I are one. He who has seen me has seen the Father who has sent me. So what am I saying here? I'm going to give you sort of a new concept that you may not be familiar with, even those of you that have studied into metaphysics. And that is that the only prayer that is answered is the prayer that God has put into our minds to pray. Well, that's a bit of a stretch, isn't it? If we take a moment and we begin to think, Jesus said, go into this state of meditation. Pray to thy Father which seeth in secret, and thy Father shall reward thee openly. Your Father knoweth what you have need of before you ask. So if God knows what you have need of before you ask, then we can take it one way or the other. We can say, well, God, philosophically, theologically, just simply said, no way. Or we can take it that the prayer was not going to happen unless it was within the will of God for it to happen. In other words, let's suppose a person isn't praying in the sense of prayer being meditation. They pray and the prayer is answered. So you say, hey, that blows your theory all to blazes. No, it doesn't. It just simply means that what for that one time, that was put into the person's mind. Well, how can it be put into the person's mind if the person isn't going into the state of meditation, the state of higher consciousness that you're talking about? Very simply, it can be an unconscious process. Well, what do you mean by an unconscious process? An unconscious process, how many hours do we spend in sleep in a 24-hour cycle? How much REM time do we have where we're actually sleeping even if we don't remember what is taking place? How many dreams that we dream are a part of being led and guided, where the deeper levels of our unconscious opens up, puts a seed thought into the subconscious mind just beneath the surface, the conscious level of the mind, and then upon waking consciousness, it pops into our mind and we pray on it. Now, it is much better to make the idea that only those that doeth the will of the Father enter into the kingdom. So it's much easier just to simply say every morning when you wake up in the morning, not my will, but thy will be done. But you see, that strikes a bad chord with most people, because as I said, for those of you that were here last Sunday, people want to be naughty. And they figure if they're going to do the will of God, they don't have a chance to be naughty. But the truth of the matter is that if you're doing the will of God, you have such a sense of wholeness, fulfillment, and so forth, you don't need to do naughty things. Because you are filled already. You remember the words, my cup runneth over. It is inside, and that, I'm not talking about being in some type of hysterical, emotional, holy roller, let's roll around the floor type of situation where religion becomes hysteria. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking in the quiet solitude and the peace of your own soul. On a day-to-day basis, there is a quiet certainty and a quiet knowingness that you go about your daily business with. Now, having said that, let's turn to the affirmation sheet that you have in your program. The first affirmation says prayer defined. It says, I understand that prayer in the Christ mind, part of my consciousness, is in truth really the practice of meditation. So let's say prayer isn't one thing and meditation something else. Of course, most people will think of it that way because most people will think, well, prayer is where you're asking for something and meditation is where you're contemplating, hopefully, on the presence of God. But you see, unless we have a connection with that presence, conscious or unconscious, it makes no difference. We have to be plugged in. Unless God, being the absolute reality of who and what we really are within ourselves, that part of that Christ part of ourselves where God and I and you and God are one in the same, unless that comes through and leaks through something into your subconscious mind which triggers that particular prayer. So now let's what I said a few moments ago, quoting from the New Testament, broken down for you. It says, whenever I pray, meaning meditate, I enter into my own mind, enter into thy own closet, as it goes in the New Testament, and shut the door behind me, as it goes in the New Testament, meaning shut off your outer senses to the exterior world, and commune in consciousness with Father, meaning God, which seeth in secret, meaning the higher consciousness within yourself. And then thy Father will reward thee openly. So what does this mean? It means that if you're meditating every day, you will pray in a certain fashion, because you will be under the influence of the God consciousness that you come into contact with through your daily meditation, which will lead you to pray in a particular way. So we could say that every prayer then is a prayer under the influence of God inside of yourself. Let's suppose at 10 o'clock this morning you go into a state of meditation. Then at 12 noon, all of a sudden you have a feeling that you want to pray about something. So you go ahead and you pray about something. That prayer, that particular thought to pray that thing, has been put into you during the state of higher consciousness that you're in. I know this is a strange way about looking about prayer, but geez, just go back to the New Testament and really take a good look at what's being said there. So therefore, when a person prays believing, they have every right to believe if they're in a state of consciousness, because God has put the prayer into their head. But if God already knows what you have need of, then why pray? Good question. Prayer then, listen to this very carefully, is done on a conscious level to allow the conscious level of your thinking to be in alignment with God's will at the deeper level of your being. Once again, prayer. Why pray then? Prayer on the conscious level of your mind is to get the conscious level of your mind into alignment with what God feels is the will that best suits you in your life. In other words, we're trying to get our house together is what we're trying to do. We're trying to let the penthouse know what's going on in the balcony or in the basement. We get our act together. See what I'm getting at? We get our act together. We converge different levels of our mind and of our consciousness. So it says, God knows, I recognize that the presence of God in my mind already knows what I truly need. That's the other thing. How many people on a conscious level feel they know what they really need? Well, most people feel that way. But how many people actually think for themselves? Come on, let's be honest. Most people don't think for themselves. They're under the influence of politicians, religions, questionable authorities to begin with. I mean, you know, let's put a big doubt there. And so, advertisers come along, all kinds of things you're told that you need, and if you don't have them, oh God, you're unhappy because the Jones next door have them and you don't have them. And yet right now, as we sit here in the United States, there are people that are sitting in mud huts in some jungle that are more happy than most of the people in cosmopolitan cities. So isn't happiness, as the bumper stickers really say, really more a state of mind and consciousness rather than what we have or don't have? So much emphasis is placed nowadays upon this frenzied search for being rich. Most people that are wealthy are not that happy. I mean, they're itching for the new model to come out to give them a temporary buzz if they can go in and buy it. They're itching for the new fashion to come in to rush and buy it to give them again a temporary buzz. And when they're not being buzzed this way, if you get close enough to them, you might see the glossy look in their eyes of drugs, or you might smell the alcohol on their breath. Come on. Let's say life as it is. That's why Jesus said it isn't impossible for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, but it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. Why? Because the person that is out just and is totally intoxicated with the idea that wealth is the end of the rainbow for them has their total focus on it. An idiot can be rich. It depends upon where you put your priorities. Haven't any of you ever met a wealthy person who is dumb as the blazes? Any of you? Come on, can I see by a show of hands? I mean, that you wonder how the blazes this person ever got wealthy? Simple. That's all that they could think about night and day. Nothing else mattered. Money, 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 money. What's a big secret about that? I see no secret about that. If you live it, you breathe it. You are it, but that's all you are. So God knows what's best for every one of us. And who is God? Not this person that's not going to allow us to do naughty things. God is the true life force inside of each and every one of us. All of us are interconnected, intertwined with one massive universal cosmic life that we call God, and it's inside of each and every one of us. Results. I understand that what is asked in prayer is only answered if it is in Christ mind consciousness meditation in which God has inspired the prayer. So you go to pray. If God has inspired the prayer, you're going to get results. If God hasn't inspired the prayer, no sale. Simple as that. I don't care if you sit there and sit there and sit there and cobwebs form all over you. It isn't going to work. You know, it isn't going to happen for you. I mean, come on, folks. Not every prayer is answered. How few prayers are answered when you get down to it? Because how few people have any real connection with God. And if God answered every prayer that everybody prayed right now, we'd have another big bang throughout this universe. You couldn't handle it. Absolutely couldn't handle it. The place would just explode. So God inspired prayer through living in prayerful meditation oneness with God. It is God who creates or inspires the prayer, which is to bring the conscious human part of my mind into alignment with God's will to manifest through me. Okay, you have basically a choice at this juncture. You've been told. Now, what do you want to do with it? Most people, when they're told, it goes back to the old thing. Having ears to hear, they hear not. Having eyes to see, they see not. Business goes on. Life goes on as usual. I mean, come on. You want prayer answered. You want a better life than you do true prayer. You get into contact and you have as much of this consciousness that you are exposed to each day as possible running through your mind, your thoughts, your awareness. Then you are intuitively given what to pray for. God knows what you have need of. God puts the idea of what you should pray for into your mind. You pray that idea. And then what are you doing? You are aligning the conscious part of your mind, your being, your efforts, your goals, your aspirations with the will of God. But the will of God is not something that's apart from you. The will of God is the real you. The Father and I are one, it means for all of us. And so when we think of this in this way, we stop praying amiss. So we go into then Christ mind prayer, which says, I recognize that in Christ mind consciousness, it is God who places a prayer into my mind to be prayed for. I know it's maybe going to take time to settle in, but that's the way it is. Now, when God puts the prayer in your mind, it's going to be answered because it's according to the will of God for you at this particular point in your life, whether you're 20 years old, 40, 60, 80, 100, it doesn't make any difference. That's what you're supposed to be doing. That's what you're supposed to be experiencing for whatever the reason. There used to be a television program many, many years ago. It was called Father Knows Best. And the truth of the matter is that God knows best with inside of each and every one of us because God is the true life of every one of us. You see, we become so mixed up in our outer sense activities and so forth, and so much a part of our environment, and so much of the behavioral science that's thrust upon us to function upon this earth, that we become confused. We become misled. We become misguided. Our view and our perspective of what life is becomes a distortion. It becomes a dim view of who and what we really are. But then as the light proverbially shines within ourselves, the darkness is removed. And suddenly we become aware, awake, and alive. The maid is not dead, but merely sleepeth. So most people are not dead spiritually, they're just sort of sleepwalking. And occasionally, for whatever the reason, whatever the pressure, whatever the stress, whatever the timing, a person wakes up. And then they begin to realize that the responsibility of everybody is theirs. They begin to realize that if they don't like the way things are on this earth, they're responsible for it. Not only responsible for their own life, but responsible for everybody else's also. Because you begin to realize there's only one life here, and that's me. Only God is present. And so if I see somebody doing something wrong over there, it's a part of me. Just like if I put out my hand and I have a hangnail and it's bothering me, I have to get rid of the hangnail. I have to do something about it. If we don't like the way that society is, we then have to bring society into alignment with that one life. But you can't do that until people are ready. And there, my friend, is the twist. And you can only teach so far spiritually until people are ready. There is no way. I mean, you can force somebody to believe anything, but as Christ put it, you can't take the kingdom of heaven by force. So you can tell somebody an absolute spiritual truth, and you can try to coerce them into believing that, but it won't last because anything that isn't truthful won't last. Remember the words, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall remain. Whatever the truth is, will be here always. The truth about you will be here always. The truth that you are eternal. And just are merely guised as a human being right now, that truth remains. Your body may disintegrate back into the elements at the end of this lifetime, but you remain. As long as you have identified yourself with that which is eternal, in Christianity, it is the symbol of Christ. In other religions, cultures, the mysticism and so forth, it can take on other things. It can be nirvana, pure mind, eternal mind. It can be samadhi, Brahman. The idea is that we associate and identify closely with that which is eternal within ourselves. And so when we pray the eternal prayer. Eternity prays through us. He who loses himself, meaning a personal sense of oneself, for my sake, for the sake of the eternal within, finds himself, and therefore prays the true prayer, right for that manifestation of God individualized as you. Think of it this way. We can go up to some observatory, and we can look through a telescope, and we can peer out into outer space. And perhaps theologically, philosophically, mystically, as we peer out, we can think to ourselves, this is just the mind of God extended out ad infinitum. Consciousness ad infinitum. And then at the same time, we can think to ourselves, as we look into this vast, vast cosmos, that all of these cosmos have involved, not evolved, but involved themselves into you. As if this entirety of this universe, consciousness, has involved itself, individualized itself as you. As above, so below. He who has seen me has seen the universe who has sent me. The universe manifests as me. God manifests as me. God manifests as you. We are one in the same. One of us may be taller, another one may be a little bit more shorter. One may be thinner, one may be a little bit more stout, but we're all the same. There's only one life here, only one life on this planet, only one life that is this planet, only one life that is the sun, only one life that is the solar system, the galaxy. And it is that one life that prays through us the individualized purpose for which it is here. So it says, already so, I understand that all Christ mind prayer is under the influence of God and is successful because it is already so in the mind of God. It's already so. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Each of you is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Whatever will be already is. Whatever has been will always be. We live in one eternal moment of unmeasurable time. So, whatever will be already is. And again, you say, well, if that's the case, why pray? That's the point. You connect. You pray. Prayer, then, is a connection. It isn't an asking. It is just a connection with the infinite mind and spirit of the universe and of God, in which whatever you would pray for is already yours already. And according then to your faith that this is so, then be it unto you. Because it's already so, then you become as the lilies of the field. They spin and they toil not with their prayers, and yet they grow. And which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit to their stature, which you already are? You already are. Stop thinking about it. Just be one with it. Stop all of this unnecessary thinking. Just be one with it. What are you one with? Be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. That's the admonition. Oh, that's a lulu for a human being to take on. To be as perfect as God, why not? You are God in manifestation. But you say, oh no, I'm a slob. I'm mediocre. I've failed so many times. That's only because you haven't lived your true self. I'm just simply suggesting, live your true self. Stop all this whining. Break down the wailing wall. Stop being a victim. You know, you can go and you can cry and say, woe is me, this person did that to me, that person did this to me, I pray that they're out of my life. Well, pray first of all that you have life for somebody to be out of. Which comes first, the chicken or the egg? In the New Testament, one thing that hasn't been brought out in the Christian church, unfortunately, and that is that death was not physical death, it was spiritual death. Whenever you saw death in the New Testament, it refers to spiritual death, which is far worse than physical death. Because if you have spiritual death, you're worse off than being dead. So, how can that be? Well, that's why you turn to all of the escapisms. That's why you become neurotic. That's why you become psychotic. You can't handle your own denials. You can't handle the narcissistic type of situation that you're living in. You can't handle that there's something wrong with playing this idea of victimhood all day long. And so we grow. We be as the lilies of the field. They spin, they toil not, and yet they grow, they persevere. So alignment. I recognize that Christ mind prayer is an alignment of my mortal, of the mortal part of my mind with that, with what is already so in the immortal Christ God mind. Going back to the alignment. You pray just to get the conscious part of your mind in alignment with the God part of your mind. That's why you pray. And you realize that your prayer is God-inspired. Isn't that something? This is the way that Jesus looked at it. And if you go back and you read the New Testament as far as the instructions on prayer, it's right out in front of people, but the reason traditional Christianity hasn't brought it up is because if they bring it up, they open up the whole can of whatever, and people suddenly realize that they don't need religion. All they need is their God-given connection, and so religion loses its popularity and it loses its cash flow. Simple. What is so complicated about all of this, except the complications that we wish to put on it to avoid the truth and the reality, to allow us to be naughty another day in our minds, to get drunk because we don't have enough of God in our life, to get high on some idiotic drug, to allow the drug companies to pull us around by the nose, manipulate us, to use all forms of mass media under the guise of all kinds of things, so that you're taking, how many drugs are you sold on television Ask your doctor if X is right for you. Well, during the commercial, they've never even told you what X even does. Have you noticed how many commercials will not even tell you what X even does, but they will say at the end, ask your doctor if X is right for you. Do you understand how dumb they think you are?
Yeah.
It's sad, isn't it? That these greed mongers,
that's right,
so manipulate. I remember I had one trip a few months ago up to Sedona to the school, and I dropped in there to make the acquaintance of one MD that was practicing alternative medicine. I wanted to meet him. And I happened to mention to him, I said, you know, I said, I saw recently in one newsletter how the drug companies were sending all of these good-looking models to call as manufacturers' reps to the doctors as far as to bring in new medications and so forth. He says that isn't news. It's been going on for years. So, okay. So what do you have? You have manipulation. You have lobbyists. You have all kinds of sellouts, buyouts, and everything else. You have such corruption that's why it said, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the Pharisees and the scribes, there's no way you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. No way is it going to happen. If your sense of righteousness, your sense of goodness, and so forth, is the equivalent of these slobs, there's no way. You're not in the energy level. You are in the false energy level. So when you pray, first you get into the right energy level. You get into the flow. All of you know the expression, we got to be in the flow. The flow is in you. You're part of the universal flow, the ebb and tide of universal life inside of each and every one of you. That's your spirituality. Where's your church? It isn't here. You're sitting in it. You're sitting in your church. Not what's around you. You are the church of God. You are the temple of God. It says so in the Bible. Labor not ye that try to build the temple of God with mortar and brick. You are the temple of God. You are the synagogue of God. You are the mosque of God. You are it. And don't let these idiots try to tell you different, that one religion is better than another religion, that one peoples are the chosen people. All of this bull, all of this nonsense, all of these things that cause divisions because they know like a dictator.
Yeah.
If we can split and divide the people, they will become uncertain and they will look to us for guidance. And therefore we can pick their pockets and live in this luxury all that we want to. And so you have made it a den of thieves, as Jesus said. But the den of thieves was not necessarily the physical temple of those days. The den of thieves becomes the den of thieves within ourselves. Where if we worship just the golden calf, thinking that riches alone is the end aim of life, we have made this body, this mind that we live in, the den of thieves. And therefore, we need to have the tables turned over, our thoughts turned over, our consciousness turned over. And we need to be, as I've said time and again, have a psychic enema. Okay?
Oh,
we need to be cleaned out. We need the garbage removed. All right, intuitively created prayer. God intuitively gives me knowing of what to pray for based on what is best for me And it manifests as it is already so in the mind of God. Once again, God intuitively gives me knowing of what to pray for based on what is best for me, and it manifests as it is already so in the mind of God. That is how it works. So again, prayer is answered when prayer is put into our minds from God, which is the true life and the ultimate life of our body, our Christ self. When it is put into our minds and you pray, God already knows what you're going to pray for because God put the prayer into your mind. And the reason then you're going through the motions of praying is simply to align the conscious part of your mind with the will of God, which is best for you. That's how you can sum it up in a few words. Now let's take, if you would, sit back in your chairs for a few moments, and let's center in on that consciousness that is inside of each and every one of us. Let's turn inward, as it were, to that higher reality that is within. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments into the inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To walk the footsteps in mind that Jesus walked into the state of Christ mind and light within himself, to travel that same inner road to a destiny of light that exists at the very center and nucleus of my mind. And so I turn inward now to seek that greater state of consciousness and reality that is here within me. A state of beingness, a state of knowingness, a state of consciousness, a state of reality. And so I let go of that which is the outer part of me, that I may center in on that which is the inner part of me. That part of me which was before this body was, is while this body is, and will be long after this body is no longer. And so I move from the outer state of my beingness to the innermost state of consciousness within me, letting go of all that is not of the real me, in order to be able to find that Christ-like point of consciousness at the center of my being. And so I travel inward seeking a speck of light to become a universe of light with which I am eternally one. And let me feel now that I have entered into the Holy of Holies, for I have entered into myself. That I seek the upper room of consciousness, meaning the higher consciousness within myself, that I may move in that state of beingness, be one with that state of Christ mind, be one with the God mind, with which I am eternally one. For let me know here within myself, in the corridors of my own mind, that I am part of one eternal pathway being traveled by the universe and individualized as my human shape, form, and embodiment. Let me feel this. Let me be one with it. Let me breathe the breath of spirit. Let me live the life of God, pulsing through every bit of my beingness. Let it immerse my very soul in the spirit that is eternal light here within myself. Let me open all levels of my mind to that light, to that awareness that is Christ-like, one with God here within myself. Let me enter into that place within myself where the I am of I am is, that I may say I am that which I am, here in the reality of God's presence within me. I ask this knowing that it is already mine in the mind of God, and so it is. Now I'll sit for a few moments in a state of quietness, feeling that when I open my eyes, I will keep a connection between my innermost soul and the life of the universe that is God within me, that it is God that will put forth my every prayer, my every thought, my direction, and my guidance. And so now, ever so slowly, let me begin to open my eyes. And as I open my eyes, let me stretch my arms and hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars of the heavens of universal life, mind, and spirit, having individualized into human shape, form, and embodiment, indeed as me. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace and the security that this is so, and so it is.